Hello everyone, in this video I will present a joint work with Pierre Alain Fouque about division property. So division property was introduced by Todo at Eurocrypt 15 and it's a method to find sophisticated integral distinguishers. Originally, to search for integral distinguishers, we started with a collection of plain text such that one word takes all the possible values while the other ones remain constant through the encryption process. And then we observe that the corresponding ciphertext, if we sum all of them, then at least one word will sum to zero. With division property, we can be a bit more precise because we will look at the polynomial expressions of internal component of the encryption function. So let's take three variables x, y, and z such that y is equals to f of x and z is equals to g of y, and x, y, and g and z belong to some finite field. Now, given mz a monomial in the z variables, then mz can also be seen as a polynomial in the y variables, and so involving only my monomials. And the two-subset division property only states that if each my appearing in mz are such that if we sum them through over some particular set of inputs, and if they sum to zero, then mz will also sum to zero for the same particular set of inputs. So it is called two-subset division property because we can split the monomials into two sets. One set containing the monomials for which we know they sum to zero, and one set of monomials for which we don't know whether they sum to 0 or to 1. There are also two extra variants for division property. The first one is the three-subset division property, in which we have a third subset in which monomials sum to 1. And in that case, the property becomes if each my sum to 0 but 1, then mz sums to 1. And we also have the exact division property variant in which we will count how many my sum to 1, and mz will sum to 0 if and only if this number is even. So, however, in practice, we don't perform the sum over any random set X. We compute the sum over a cube of variables, exactly as for cube attacks. And in that case, the division property is exactly equivalent to the presence or the absence of some monomials in a polynomial. And typically, it only means that if for each monomial, if each monomial my of mz does not depend on a monomial mx, then mz also does not depend on mx, right? And here depend on means that there is one monomials which is greater than mx. And we and so division property can be used to know which are the biggest monomials involved in some polynomial P. So in practice, given a complicated function f, too big so we cannot compute directly its ANF, the division property will be used to get some information about the biggest monomials of f. So the first step is to decompose f into smaller layers, into several small layers. And for each of those layers, we need to be able to compute the ANF of each output bits and also of each product of output bits. So they are very small layers, typically small S boxes or binary operations. And the problem of division property, not really the problem, but the accuracy of division property does depend on the decomposition we chose for f. The problem is that division property does not really well handle the XOR operation because it cannot track the cancellation of monomials. I mean, for the two subset division property, if we have we cannot track the cancellation of monomials. For the exact variant of division property, we will obviously take it into account. But for the two subset division property, we cannot. And so the decomposition is very important in the accuracy of the process. So typically, to compute the valid transition through a small layer, here I also called it f, for an n to m bit function f, we will have to compute 2 to the m ANF, one for each product of the output bits of f, and each of those ANF involves n variables, so at most to the n monomials. So the overall complexity of the algorithm to compute all the valid transitions through f is in 2 to the 3n for an n to n bit function. So 2 to the 3n is low enough to be to apply the algorithm for up to n equals to 16. But in practice, we applied it on much smaller operations like a small 8-bit S-box or 4-bit S-box. So our first idea when we started this work was to be able to compute the propagation table associated to a super S-box. Two super S boxes. Okay, super S boxes are obtained by combining one S box layer, one linear layer, and another S box layer. And of course, there is a key addition inside the super S box. Because for 64-bit block ciphers, the super S-box is a 16 to 16-bit function for if the key is fixed. Okay, and so in theory, we can apply the algorithm from Xiang et al. To compute its propagation table. But because there is the key, the key has to be taken into account, and we have a collection of 2 to the 16 to 16-bit functions, and we want to compute the propagation table of such collection of functions. And why we want to do that? It's because it will remove some decompositions. It will remove some of the functions into inside the decomposition of our target. And we hope it will be more accurate because it will handle Cancellation of Monomials through the Super Xbox. So that's what we did. Basically, we adapted the original algorithm to now takes as input a collection of k n-bit functions. So in practice, a k n to m bit functions. And this algorithm outputs the propagation table containing all the transitions which are valid for at least one of the functions. I want to stress that this is not a weak-key model because for division property, we have a distinguisher if and only if there is no division trail. And in our case, if there is no division trail, then it means there is no division trail whatever the function chose inside the collection of k functions. Okay, because as long as a transition is valid for one function, we add this valid transition inside into the propagation table. So we mainly so this algorithm is mainly based on the original algorithm. We only reorganized the computations, and the main advantage that computing the collection, the propagation table of the collection of a collection of k n-bit functions is upper bounded by k n 2 to the 2 n plus 2 to the 3 n, which is much lower than k times 2 to the 3 n if we only naively called the original algorithm k times. But in practice, the 2 to the 3 n is still an upper bound, and it's much faster in practice. To give you an example, we were able to compute the propagation tables associated to the Super S-boxes of LED, Midori 64, Skinny 64, I think for Twine, for Hite, a lot of block ciphers, and it takes about 2 hours on a 128 core server. For Skinny 64, it's a bit it's faster because actually only 2 to the 8 there are only 2 to the 8 functions in the collection because only 2 bytes two nibble of the key of key. So that was our first result. We were able to compute the propagation tables associated to Super S boxes. The second part of our work was about extended distinguishers. We know that division property is not linearly invariant, mainly because it badly handles the XOR operation. And for instance, if we take this function f here, which is some polynomial times x plus some polynomial times y, and so on. We can observe that x and y appears in both output bits of these functions. But if, for instance, P0 is equal to P2, then the XOR of both output bits does not depend on x anymore. And similarly, if P0 is equal to P1, then the first component does not depend on x plus y. And so if we change the basis, for instance, if we change, we add a linear mapping x and x plus y, then this function will now not depend on one of the components. It does not depend on x plus y. So it's very important to search for possible linear mappings to add at the front or the end of the cipher because it might lead to new distinguishers. So we started this work with Baptiste Lambin. in a paper published in DCC, and basically we propose to try all invertible matrices in front of a layer. And so the complexity was 2 to the n squared, which is quite huge, and it can be only applied for a 4-bit S-box, typically. Still, it led to some good results against rectangle. But now, in this paper, with Pierre-Alain, we found that looking at invertible matrices was not needed. In practice, we only have to look at linear combinations of involved bits. So for the output, it's obvious. There is no need to look at invertible matrices. We just have to look at the linear combination of bits, mainly because when we search for a distinguisher, we search for division trail, and it has to happen on one particular bit, right? It's not on the product of output bits. At the input, it's a bit more sophisticated, but what we proved is that actually the existence or the absence of a distinguisher only depends on the vector space spawned by constant linear combination of bits. And so if you don't want to optimize the data complexity of your distinguisher, so basically all input bits will be at 1 and only 1 will be at 0, then there is only one constant bit, and so a linear space of dimension 1, and so you only have to exhaust all subspace of dimension 1 that will be constant. And it's very important because it really decreases the search space for extended distinguishers. And still, so we now have 2 to the n linear mapping to try for at the front of the cipher, 2 to the n linear mappings to try for at the end of the cipher. And so it means trying 2 to the 2n extended distinguishers. And searching for one distinguisher is not a trivial operation, so it's start to be quite a lot. Hopefully, we found that there are minimal pairs of linear mappings such that if there is no distinguishers for those pairs, then there is no distinguisher for all other pairs. And in practice, there are not so many pairs to try for. The second advantage of this technique is that it combines well with the Super S-boxes because we can now apply the technique in front of a Super S-box or at the output of a Super S-box. So now we have the propagation tables of Super S-boxes and our framework for extended distinguishers. But most approaches to search for division trails are based on generic solvers as SAT or MILP solvers. And the problem is the number of valid transitions inside propagation tables of Super S-boxes are huge. So typically, it's like 4 million of valid transitions for the Super S-box of Midori. And describing those tables into SAT or MILP constraints should lead to a very inefficient model. At least, that's what we thought at the time we wrote this paper. But I have to mention here that Udo Venko solved this problem in a recent paper published at EjectScript 21, in which he successfully encoded the constraint describing the propagation tables of super S-boxes into a SAT model. Still, in our case, we choose to use an ad hoc tool to search for division trails. So it is based on a basic branch and bound approach, and it is dedicated to 64-bit block ciphers. So more precisely, we require that the ciphers can be decomposed into such kind of operations, meaning for 16 to 16-bit operations and a nibble permutation. But it's still very generic, okay? Because the 16 to 16-bit operation here can be either a linear mapping or can be a super S-box, but can be also some S-boxes in parallel, right? There is no more requirement that a 16 to 16-bit functions. Even so, it can be decomposed into a smaller layers. We just require that the target can be decomposed with such operations. We also implemented a low data mode. So basically, for the arming weight of the input, it can be for each 16 to 16-bit function, it can be either 16, 15, or 0. And that's the mode we implemented. So it led to very good results. So for instance, against Midori 64, we were able to find distinguisher against 9 rounds, while previous best known results were against 7 rounds. For both Skinny 64 and height, we were able to find distinguishers against one more round than previously. We were also able to find low data complexity distinguishers. For instance, we found distinguishers requiring only 2 to the 15 plain text against both 6 round Midori 64 and 8 round Skinny 64. Regarding the running time of our algorithm, it takes few minutes for both Midori 64 and Skinny 64 on our 128 core server, but it took many days for height, more than 10 days to be precise. So for instance, for height, the decomposition to fit the requirement of our dedicated tool is that we consider two branches as a super S-box, as super S-box, right? So this function is a super S-box, this function is also a super S-box, and this function is a super S-box, and this function is also a super S-box, and then there is a nibble permutation. Okay, so it's to show you that it's very generic, and it does not only apply to SPN block cipher. Okay, it can be applied to Festel as well. Speaking of height, an interesting thing to note is that all the integral distinguishers we found against 20 rounds required a linear mapping at the input and a linear mapping at the output. And this is very interesting because at AsiaCrypt 20, Eborn et al. Introduced the all maximal degree monomials property to ensure security against integral distinguishers. And while they took into account the linear mappings at the end of a cipher, they didn't took into account linear mapping at the front of the cipher. And for instance, with such properties, they would have state that 20 round height is secure against integral distinguisher, while it is not. Finally, the title of the paper was improving the precision of division property. So it was important to verify whether we did improve the precision of division property or not. So we compared the valid trail through S-boxes and classical approach, meaning looking at valid trail through the first S-box, then the linear layer, then the second S-box. And we found that half of the division trails for the classical approach are actually false positive trails, meaning they are not in the propagation table of the super S-box. And we also studied a bit how they are spread, how those false positive trails are spread over the different inputs. And more, and it really depends on the Hamming weight of the input. For low Hamming weight inputs, considering the super S-box does not really improve the precision of division property because there is not so many false positive trails. But for inputs with high Hamming weight, we found that, for instance, for Midori 64, if the Hamming weight is at least 9, if the Hamming weight of the input is at least 9, then for sure, always for each input with Hamming weight greater or equals to 9, there is at least one false positive trail with the classical approach. And that seems quite a lot. We did the same experiment for Skinny 64, and we obtained very similar results. There are a bit less false positive trails, but still a lot, like 3 millions of false positive trails. And since the S-box used in Skinny 64 is a bit weaker than the one used in Midori 64, we found false positive trails even for inputs with Hamming weight equals to 2. So finally, to conclude, in this paper, we proposed a new algorithm to compute the propagation table of a collection of functions, including super S-boxes. We proposed new extended integral distinguishers, a new way to find integral distinguishers, and how to study minimal pairs of linear mappings. We also propose a new algorithm to remove unnecessary elements from propagation tables. So I didn't present this part, but you can find it in the paper. We implemented a new ad hoc tool to search for integral distinguishers based on those previous results. And the code is publicly available at the address right here. And if you have any questions, feel free to send me an email. And finally, we found new results against Midori 64, Skinny 64, and height. Okay, thank you for your attention.